I'm Dr. Art Uhlein. What you have just seen is a simulation of the world of the fetus, the unborn child. For centuries, scientists and laymen alike have wondered what that world must seem like to the unborn. Perhaps a part of that answer can be found here, at the sea. Time and again, we are drawn to the sea. It's an endless source of beauty, mystery, and wonder. This is where we come from, not just in evolutionary terms, going back millions of years, but in the here and now, going back only as far as the time of our own conception. For 9 months, each of us developed in a fluid world within the uterus, our own primeval sea. At birth, we're delivered from that world and thrust into the violent and blaring realities of life. We've long known about the physical hazards the infant experiences during delivery, but some scientists are suggesting that this event can be emotionally traumatic to the newborn as well, perhaps the most painful moment of its life. In the next half hour, we'll explore the birth process and examine the question of emotional birth trauma. We'll look at a new technique for delivery, which was developed to eliminate, or at least minimize, the shock the newborn experiences. Inherent in this approach is the belief that the fetus, long before birth, is already a responding, aware organism, acting and being acted upon in its unseen, watery world.
I think perhaps it is an oversimplification to consider the newborn new. That these babies, in fact, have a history and an awareness of what is going on long before the actual delivery process.
Well, the baby's going to be big enough.
Looking at heart rate patterns or monitoring patterns, methods of looking at babies before they're born, clearly show that these babies are in utero, are highly responsive to stimuli, the mother's awareness, fright in the mother, joy in the mother, and that all of these factors come to bear on the infant before it's born.
Sounds good.
Sound like a boy or a girl this time?
Sounds like a boy today, but I'm only wrong half the time.
The unborn's experience is intimately tied to the mother's throughout pregnancy. Contrary to the old-fashioned notion of the fetus resting undisturbed in a quiet, protected cocoon, its world is one of great activity. We now know, for example, that the fetus can hear. Much of the sound comes from the mother herself. Intestinal noises, heartbeat, even her voice can be heard. Experiments have further shown that the fetus hears external noises as well. These sounds are muffled by the amniotic fluid and the mother's abdominal wall. Nevertheless, the fetus does hear. Movement is also sensed by the developing baby. It rocks and sways inside its fluid sac as the mother moves. The sensation is different for bending, climbing, walking. From our vantage point, the abdominal wall may seem thick and impenetrable to light, but the mature fetus can see light and dark. If bright sunlight strikes the mother's nude abdomen, the fetus might sense a deep, rosy glow. If the fetus can hear, see, react to movement, what does the newborn perceive? It's here in the delivery room that the controversy arises. Is the emergence into this totally foreign environment an emotional shock? You're about to witness a typical modern delivery at one of the finest hospitals in the country. Most physicians believe that even if the child perceives what is happening, its immature brain cannot remember it. that given an uncomplicated delivery, emotional birth trauma simply does not exist.
I'm doing the episiotomy now, Jackie. See the head now, Jackie.
Starting IV.
Oh, the baby's got his eyes open. Looking
little
at
eyes.
Him. Ooh, there you go. Beautiful girl. Beautiful girl.
The delivery has been routine. Mother and daughter are fine. Those who would modify these procedures do not deny the value of modern medicine. But a French obstetrician, Dr. Frederick Leboyer, has suggested that certain changes could enhance the emotional well-being of the newborn.
Hi, Mom and Dad. Hi.
He believes, for example, that stimulating the baby to make it cry is unnecessary and emotionally jarring. He suggests the boisterous cry we all expect to hear is a cry of terror, not of good health. Bright lights may help the doctors and nurses, but Leboyer contends they only increase the shock to the newborn's raw senses. As the nurse wraps the baby in blankets, she is checking for heart rate, respiration, color, and muscle tone.
Don't have the right name for this young lady. One on top and one on bottom.
Perhaps, says Dr. Leboyer, the blanket feels harsh and irritating to a skin that has spent 9 months immersed in a warm, fluid environment.
Let's go see Mama. I need a bath, Mommy, but I'm beautiful. Her hair is kind of light.
Sometimes the parents can hold and touch the newborn infant, but usually only through sterile draping. In many hospitals, the infant is separated quickly from its parents and taken directly to the nursery for observation. The reasons? The baby might pick up infection from the mother's skin. It may lose vital body heat if left too long in the cool delivery room. Leboyer followers challenge these practices with questions which seem simple. Why not heat the delivery room so it's comfortable for the baby instead of for the doctor? If skin is such a danger, why do we allow the mother total contact with her infant just a few hours later? It's now approximately 15 minutes since birth. Parents and child are once again separated. Might greater contact between parents and child in these first few minutes of life make a difference in later years? Dr. Leboyer sees the baby's expression as anguish, a sign that the birth process has been terrifying, traumatic. Most physicians reply that all newborns look like this. The tensing of the hands they see as reflexive, a healthy body movement. The crying, they say, is vital, a sure indication that breathing is normal. The louder the cry, the better. We don't know how the baby feels, but everyone else seems pleased with this delivery. Doctors and nurses see a healthy, thriving girl.
We have our girl.
It's a crying girl.
It sure is.
7'3".
It's the same one.
The parents see a perfectly formed miracle. This is the type of delivery most widely used in the Western world. Most likely, it's the way you and I were born. The question is, if it had been different for us, would we be different? The newborn infant, hands clenched, howling, face contorted in agony. But is it really agony? Has the experience been traumatic? In a type of therapy known as primal therapy, clinicians have observed behavior in their adult patients, which they believe to be the reliving, the total reenactment of the birth process. Based on these investigations, Dr. Arthur Janov, founder of primal therapy, believes that birth trauma is real.
It is entirely possible for a fetus, let alone an infant, to feel and register pain or what we would call noxious stimuli. That is, inside the womb, they react if you put, even at 27 weeks, if you put a feather on the lips, the fetus will move away. And there are many, many examples of the fact that the fetus and the infant register the pain or noxious stimuli at birth and react to it, or react to it and then register it, as it were. So the point is that the birth trauma is laid down in the nervous system. Of that, there's very little question now in terms of neuroembryology. But you must understand that that trauma has an enormous valence, an enormous charge value, because it's being laid down on the most naive, vulnerable brain. And anything that's stamped into it at that time stays there for a lifetime in the form of tension and has an exceptionally high charge value. Some of the traumas are very simple, like coming into an air-conditioned room. The room should be much warmer because it's usually a 20, 25, 30 degree shock between womb temperature and room temperature. Too bright lights. The child does respond to very harsh lighting. That's a trauma. Drugging the mother is an exceptional trauma. It should not be done except under the dire circumstances, because the drug passes the placental barrier, gets into the fetus, and we have had patients relive being drugged and going numb and lifeless. And you can observe it and you can measure it. So that what's done in the first minutes of life are absolutely crucial. I mean, not only does an infant feel, but he feels much more than the rest of us, because he's got a wide open sensory window, a wide open brain, and he can register and code everything that's coming in. He has very little upper cortex as yet to repress out pain and, you know, to rationalize, to drink beer, to smoke cigarettes, to do all the things that most of us do to block pain. He is a defenseless being. So what you've got is a lifelong tension, which is laid down in the innermost portions of the brain and very inaccessible. Further, what that trauma does is direct one's life. And that is, it doesn't determine personality, but it shapes personality.
Many of Dr. Janot's colleagues share his beliefs about the existence of birth trauma and its effects on later life. Others do not. Nevertheless, doctors who fall into both categories are experimenting with the Leboyer technique and accumulating research data. Recently, I witnessed for the first time how the procedure is done.
The first thing one notices is the quiet. Voices, when used at all, are hushed. And in stark contrast to conventional deliveries, this one will be done in semi-darkness. As labor progresses, the lights are dimmed, even though birth is several minutes away. During pregnancy, the fetus's perception of light and noise has been buffered and muted by its fluid sac and the mother's abdominal wall. A dark, quiet, warm delivery room more closely approximates the fetus's prior environment and, according to Leboyer, thereby lessens the shock of birth. But, he says, the most essential element is to remain unrushed and patient. He claims that since all new sensations will be vividly and intensely experienced by the newborn, we must move slowly, at the baby's natural rhythm, to allow time for each new sensation to become integrated before moving on to the next. In the next minute, you will see the birth of a child, a human experience shared by all of us, but indeed a rare experience for the viewer.
Okay, I'm going to ask you to push.
Immediately after birth, the newborn is placed gently on the mother's abdomen. She cries, briefly and spontaneously, then stops.
Okay.
As mother and father massage their child, the staff waits. Everything continues to move slowly, slowly and peacefully. Dr. Leboyer believes physical contact gives reassurance to the newborn, further lessening the trauma of birth, the peacefulness of the baby's expression, the absence of crying, the alert eyes. All are indications to Leboyer that his claims are valid. If touch is the universal language of love, communication between parents and child has begun. Some doctors maintain this earlier contact will strengthen the bond between mother and child and have a lasting effect on the closeness between the two. The umbilical cord, lifeline between mother and child, remains intact still. Dr. Leboyer feels strongly that oxygen must be allowed to continue to the newborn through the umbilical cord until the cord, on its own, stops pulsating, usually 4 to 5 minutes after birth. In this way, he says, the baby's lungs can begin to take over slowly and without shock. The cord is now ready to be cut. Independent life can begin. But the procedure is not yet over. To ease the separation from the mother, Leboyer recommends holding the baby gently in a warm bath, a reassuring simulation of the fluid environment of the womb. As the baby re-experiences the weightlessness, the freedom of motion that she had during pregnancy, muscles relax, eyes open wide. Contends that the alertness and curiosity these babies show stays with them throughout life. He reports these children approach other new situations in life with the same lack of fear they experienced at birth. Dr. Leboyer also reports the vast majority of these children are ambidextrous, a puzzling finding. It will take time to prove or disprove, but scientific proof at this moment is of little concern to the exhilarated parents.
The atmosphere was nice. It really was nice having everything quiet and subdued. They were very conscientious about that. And I appreciate that. It was a smashing success, you know. Couldn't be hard for it to be better. You know, we read the Leboyer book and we begged our doctors. This way we got the tank, and the baby loved the tank. There's a lot of conflicting opinions in the world, you know, and everybody writes a persuasive book, you know. So to us it was, you know, extremely plausible. Fell right in line with our ideas, you know. But the proof is in the pudding.
Parents who have participated in Leboyer type of delivery are invariably elated and profoundly moved. For many doctors using this technique, the experience is the same. But by no means is there consensus within the medical community. Opinions range from outright enthusiasm to open-minded curiosity to serious skepticism. Perhaps the area of greatest criticism is that Dr. Leboyer's claims have never been scientifically proven.
The book is really a fantasy. It's a picture of a man who has delivered a lot of babies, and in this he just pictures what he thought happens in the baby's mind as it goes through. Are these babies going to be impressed by this or are they not? Now, there's been never any scientific study nor any proof that they are.
You know, there's no proof one way or the other, but I don't think you need the proof. I don't think you can hurt the baby by this. Maybe they aren't going to be any different of a child when they're older, but I think it's a great way to start out.
I think that we should do everything we can to make that transition from a mother's womb to the outside world as gentle and gradual as possible. And I can't see how this could in any way harm the baby.
If this were my child, I would prefer it cry as soon as possible. I know at that point in time that the child is getting sufficient oxygen to his brain to prevent any minimal brain dysfunction.
In my hands, when I'm bathing the baby or just holding the baby, I can feel the lack of tension in the baby. I can see them breathing. I'm not worried that the baby is not getting enough oxygen. I can feel tone, I can feel heartbeat, and I can watch the breathing of the baby. So as a physician, I'm not worried that some untoward problem is occurring in this newborn baby.
I think it was obvious that the baby enjoyed that. That was really good, really enjoyable, beautiful.
I think that even for an obstetrician who's participated in many deliveries, is very impressive indeed that the baby does not cry, that one is able to, if you will, stifle the crying and the screaming of the newborn period, and yet have these babies do perfectly well.
They're very alert. They seem to enjoy the skin contact with the parents. And above all, they seem to relax incredibly in the bath. And I've seen babies just open their eyes and look around, which is something we never saw when the lights were very bright.
I've had at least three babies who have smiled at me about three, at least within 24 hours after birth. What the significance of that is, I don't know.
I don't think the baby's impression is going to last in these babies. I don't think they conceive or react to it. Smart thing.
It looks like it really happened. I mean, a happy baby, probably happy baby. It's very rewarding, you know.
You can't have been either in the room directly or via the medium of film and not have appreciated the warmth and the tenderness and the genuine human quality of what transpired just now.
Just as the warmth of the sun is essential for life, so human warmth is essential for emotional well-being. Our need for love is basic, universal, and lifelong. Supporters of the Leboyer method believe that by reducing the physical trauma at birth, they're providing the newborn with more immediate love. Is this in fact so? Will it improve the quality of life for future generations? Opponents say it will set the scientific clock back 30 years. At this point, neither position is justified by the existing evidence. Only time and further research will tell. Our children are the hope for the future, the hope for mankind. It is essential that the research be done, that we pursue the answers vigorously, conscientiously, and with love.